Okay, so let me just ask you guys some questions and you fill in the blanks.
Gotcha.
Okay, so we're gonna start with... Okay, tell me about yourself.
Born in Snowflake, Arizona, 7-Eleven, which is why I'm always fortunate and lucky, 7-Eleven 46.
I was born December 31st in Provo, Utah, and my dad always said I was his favorite little tax exemption because I was born just 9 hours before the new year.
Dad loved football just like I have. He was the quarterback for the Snowflake High School team. He went to every game that we had that he could get to. He worked for the airlines, but he came home with stories almost every day that he went to work. He'd have some story about somebody that did something stupid or something that was quite funny. My mom came from Rexburg, Idaho. She was born there. Mom was not as happy-going as my dad. She worried about things more than he. So I had my older brother, Rick, and then me. And then my first sister was Elizabeth. And then my brother, Ron. Then my sister, Maxine. Well, I was probably closest with Ron, even though Rick was a year older. Ron was quite a bit younger than I, but he kind of tagged around behind me. If I was going to the weight room, he would want to go with me.
My two older sisters are Janice and Janelle. They were twins, and they are 6 years older than I am. And my younger brother, Gary, is 6 years younger than I am. I didn't do a lot with my older sisters because by the time I was in junior high, they were off to college. For all my life, as long as I remember, my dad called me George. And we would always play cowboys and Indians. I was a natural tomboy. That's just how it was. And one day, my dad was coming around the corner of our garage, and he heard me say to Clyde, my cousin, I said, "You be Bill and I'll be George," in the cowboy scenario. So from that day on, he called me George, or Little George. Even when we were getting married, I was George. I actually grew up in a place called Ashtonville. It was before it was in the Provo City. And it was right at the edge of BYU campus where that is now, but it was Ashtonville. We always had cousin activities going on. And that's the thing I love about even now, because I love that our family lives close by, our kids and our grandkids, and we kind of have a cousin community just like I grew up in. I love it. I didn't like playing with dolls. And my mom, I think, always felt bad about that, because for Christmas every year, I would get a doll. And she would spend hours and hours making doll clothes for me. And so I'd always play with that doll on Christmas Day so that she wouldn't feel bad. And then I don't think I picked it up very much again. I was not into the girly things until probably, you know, into some sixth grade, seventh, eighth, I started having more girlfriends. And then just in our ward and in our stake, my mom would always just have me perform. She taught me songs. She taught me, you know, to sing and dance.
Snowflake, my father was the bishop, a ward of about 1,000 members, but lots of inactives. Then he had an offer from the U.S. government to go to Mexico to help them eradicate hoof and mouth disease in their cattle. We were there another 2 to 3 years, so we came out of Mexico probably 3 years later. We moved to Mesa when I was about 5. We lived on Hobson Street, a little 2-bedroom house. And we then started construction of a house over on 6th Street. At that time, 6th Street existed only as a dirt road off of Country Club. We just moved in there and we took care of the grove, we called it. I was just playing with matches, just exactly like I shouldn't have been doing, and caught it on fire because the scrub grass there was about 1 foot high. So then, I'm sure it was my dad's requesting, but the fire department chief had a little interview with me.
And did it work?
Yeah, I never played with matches again, or not risky-wise. At Rendezvous Park, they also had a big diamond there where the Cubs practiced. I was there when 2 of the kids got in a fight. It was a black kid and a white kid. The black kid that was losing the fight kept calling for his brother to go get his brother. So we heard that the brother was on his way and we were all deathly afraid of the brother. We all headed for our bicycles. I could not get mine unlocked. And so the other guys arrived. And I have a broken tooth. To this day, when I got in a fist fight with these guys, that was not my fault. It had nothing to do with the original fight.
Did you swing punches?
Yes, I did.
That's
my point of pride. I've never fixed it. But then I started playing football in 9th grade. Freshmen, we were undefeated. Sophomores, we were undefeated. And as a sophomore, I didn't do very well. I played a lot, but I just was kind of middle of the road. I worked the summers up in Idaho for my uncles. And so when I came back, this, again, now I'm a junior. But when I got there, it was already time for practice to start. And we had this new coach. But this coach, Sharkey Price, saw me coming over, asked me my name, and he said, "Where have you been?" And I told him that I'd been working the farm. He says, "Well, you're my starting guard. I've been waiting for you." That really shouldn't be a sentimental thing, except it pretty well changed my life. We went on to go undefeated, which was the first time in years that a Mesa, or even anywhere in the state, that they were undefeated state champions. But I was then named as first string All-State by all of the major newspapers in the state. That changed my life because then I signed to go to BYU on a football scholarship.
When did you decide to go on a mission?
I decided to go for the wrong reason. It's interesting that that's not what makes me cry, but football does. I had to decide before fall football at BYU, but I didn't like my life was going. I thought, what I need is to get away from here and just go on vacation for a couple of years. That sounds like a mission, right? I'll just go on a vacation. People will be sorry to see me leave. When I come back, I'll be bigger and stronger, and I'll be fine. So I received my call to go to the Argentine North Mission. And I was a pompous idiot. Our group was one group, or maybe 10 of us in one group. and I thought, if Elder Walters is my companion, I'm going home. He was about 110 pounds, and he was always hitching up his belt like this. That bugged me. So he tried to just help me. I remember the first time I was sitting in a sacrament meeting and just had a complete change of heart. I could understand what they were saying, and it was all in Spanish. You're editing all of those, right? So I started to really get along with Elder Walter, who all he did was try to help me the whole time. We all ended up going to the North Argentine Mission together, headquarters in Córdoba. Just had so many good experiences, but the most important one was that my mission president was Richard G. Scott. He did more to change me than anything else. Great experience, and I had an opportunity to work out of the office one time, and then back out in the field, and then back in the office as his assistant. So I really was able to spend a lot of time with him, driving him around, and doing stuff like that. I wouldn't change that for anything. My testimony increased, and I had a real positive, good mission. You have to love people. If you can't love the people, then don't bother.
Let's see, and this was 1968 when we met in February, and Lance had just come home from a mission a few months before that and was just up at BYU, and he was living with Lynn Bedford. And Jeannie was, my friend, was dating Lynn Bedford. And so they hooked us up on a blind date. We went up to Salt Lake and saw a movie. And that was kind of, you know, that was an extreme expensive date to go to Salt Lake.
Went to a movie. Went out to eat. That already expended my money for the month, probably.
What did you think of Margie when you first met her?
Perky. Cute. Good sense of herself.
I just thought he was the nicest, kindest boy I had ever dated. He was just very easy to get along with, to talk to. I could see right away, though, that I could teach him how to have fun. He needed a little bit of push. I thought I would like to go out with him again. And I hoped he wanted to go out with me again.
One of my dad's teachings to me was marry someone that gets along with your friends. And they all loved her. She was great around everybody.
Tell me about when Lance proposed.
What did he tell you about this?
We had talked about it. It's not the romantic part that most young women would want to see.
We dated that first semester at BYU, and he came down from West Yellowstone where he was working for the summer. I remember that was maybe the first time that he actually said, you know, would you marry me? And so I said, well, of course, you know, because we had kind of talked about it before. And I said, yes, for sure. So we kind of talked about it, left it at that. He went back for the summer to West Yellowstone. When he came back to school in the fall, we actually started looking for rings. He got the ring, and one night we were just taking a ride in somebody's borrowed car, I'm sure, and riding around. We went up around the loop up Provo Canyon, and then we came back, and we went up on Oak Hills, on top of Oak Hills, up above the Provo, where the Provo Temple is now.
We just parked out at Lover's Lane, that we called it, up on the hill, and we'd already talked about marriage, but now I had the ring. So I didn't get out of the car and get on one knee, no. I just said, how's that ring fit? Or something as unromantic as that.
And he asked me again, he says, will you marry me? And I said, just kind of says, well, of course, I told you I would. You know, yes, I love you. And so then he pulled out the ring, gave me the ring, and that was it, the official proposal, I guess.
We got engaged late summer, got married in December, on December 14th, in the Manti Temple. I think the Salt Lake Temple was closed or something. But my uncles from Rexburg that I'd worked my heart out for, they came with their wives, a couple of cousins.
My Aunt Leah and Uncle Tony were there, and my two sisters, Janice and Janelle, came from my family, were there. And so there were probably 20, 25 people there. We had a luncheon at BYU. It was one of the first times that I remember seeing my dad cry, was at that luncheon, and just getting teary-eyed. He was very sick then when we got married with his cancer. And so I just thought that was a real emotional time. And then we moved on and had our reception at our ward building, at the Pleasant View Ward building. We had it all decorated with Christmas trees. And so we had a great reception and got in the car and took off and went to our little apartment that we had rented in Orem.
Oh, the first year was fun. We did a lot of things together. We had friends in the marriage student housing.
We were both working, both going to school, and so things were crazy and it was busy. We didn't know we were poor because everybody else around us were students that were doing the same thing we were doing.
All right, so all the children are Jessica, Amy, David, Melanie, Melissa, Mike, Scott, Steve, Kayleen, Afton.
Mom and Dad always said they never discussed how many kids they wanted to have. They just, we were going to kind of take what came. And Mom always said she seemed to get pregnant on every form of birth control. So there you go, we've got 10.
The family's broken up into parts. And so it was the oldest three, Jessica and Amy and David. And then the middle four probably, which was, the twins and Mike and myself. And then the last group was the babies or the younger kids.
Jessica's the oldest. She has been really a pretty easy keeper.
She's definitely the person in charge. She's in charge. She's an oldest child. And I think she does a very good job at that.
I was always proud to be the oldest. I always liked being the oldest. But I think it took on some extra responsibility. It was me trying to herd the cats.
Her role, I think she was an example. She was, when I was a kid, I saw an older sister who was going to college and, doing those things.
We were pretty fortunate to have her be the first. She was always, from the time she was little, an organizer.
When Jessica was little, she was always seemed like she was older. She always seemed like she was just an adult in a little kid body. She just kind of liked things how she liked them. There was no gray matter. It's black and white. It's right and wrong. And she knew what she, wanted to do. And she just always, she was always that way.
Well, Amy was a good second child. Amy was a little more easygoing.
From what I understand, I was an incredibly wonderful baby. I just sort of went with the flow a little bit more.
But she was cooler than me and had better clothes than me and was much more fashionable, knew how to do makeup and hair and knew how to dress, and she had lots of friends.
I think we were lucky to have those two girls first.
David was the first boy. He, I know Dad adored David, and they loved doing things together.
He could play football, and he could play basketball, and he did gymnastics, and so he was very sports-minded, which we knew that my dad liked, because my dad was like that. But he also played well with all of us girls.
But Dave was always my favorite brother. I remember one time when I was young, in kindergarten even, he took me to a movie all by myself, and it was just, to this day I remember it.
David spent the least amount of time in our home. He was always with friends.
If David wasn't home, we could always find him at Corey's or Trent's or Ryan's or someplace. We knew he was with his friends always.
Can I say Dad's favorite? I'm going to say Dad's favorite. That's his role in the family.
There have been comments that Dave might be your personal favorite. Why would you? I'm not saying whether or not that's true, but why would you think people would get that impression?
Because it's partly true. David liked the same things that I liked, so we've enjoyed each other. But I have with all my children, and some see it different than others.
I remember crying at David's wedding because I was so sad he was getting married and leaving the house. And which is now crazy because I probably like Stacy more than I like David now.
The first three children, I thought, oh, this is a piece of cake. Jessica, Amy, David, there's nothing I can't do. These kids are going to be A-okay. Then I had the twins. And all hell broke loose.
The twins then came, Melanie and Melissa, and we were so excited to be having twins come into the family. And I know Mom, I'm sure, feels much different about twin babies coming to the family when there was already three little kids.
The first two, maybe even 3 years of their life could be summed up in one word: nightmare. Those twins were a mess to raise the first 2 or 3 years. They were good, cute, beautiful little girls, but there was two of them and they were into everything.
Melanie and Melissa brought a lot of excitement to the family, a lot of chaos too. So there's five of us now, and all very young.
Melanie, I don't know if it was because she was the oldest by 5 minutes, was always the in charge twin, and Melissa was always more of a go with the flow.
Melanie and Melissa would come home from school and instantly go take a nap. And they would tell me, wake me up at 3:50, because then they had to get ready to go to work, where they were the Sonic twins and worked at the Sonic Drive-In just down the road. And I always remember thinking that they were famous for that. Like, they were a big deal for working at Sonic, and they were called the Sonic twins.
From an outside perspective, I would say that they were the cool kids. I remember them being popular, whatever that meant back then, but I remember them being the cool kids and just having a lot of friends, and I can remember wanting to be like them.
I don't know how many years it took before Dad could tell them apart. They were just twin and the twins.
I could not tell them apart. I tried. I could not tell them apart.
And sometimes you still can't.
Even now, there are times.
They are always going to be called the twins, and I know some twins just hate that terribly, and luckily Melanie and Melissa have always been okay with that. And then immediately after the twins, it was very fast, came Mike and Scott, and then a little bit later Steve.
Mike was a mover. He wanted to be everywhere, doing everything. I remember very specifically one time he was in the office in my mom and dad's back room. That's where the office was. And he was just sure that if he put the cape on and jumped from the desk, he was going to be able to fly. He just knew that he could do it. And he jumped. And he went straight down onto the chair first and then onto the floor, and it was ugly. But he always had something broken. He had a collarbone broken and a leg broken, and Mike was very, very active.
And Mike has some really good qualities. Sometimes it's hard for people to see that in him. If you were driving with him and there was a guy on the street asking for money, and I always think, well, it's a scam. Work for your money, but no, not Mike. Mike will give him $5.
A lot of times it was nice to have Mike around for me. I mean, he probably protected me on several occasions as I was a kid, and you know, people knew I was Mikey's brother. They didn't want to mess with me.
To this day, if I have an issue with my bike, I bring it over to Mike, and he usually jimmy-rigs something up and fixes it.
Yeah, he can tear anything apart and put it back together.
He's when Afton was born, he loved Afton. Would rubber head. If we'd go on a long trip, he would sit by Afton. But Afton was a baby.
He still loves babies and the little kids. We all come into this life to learn. That's why we're here, is to learn things. And there are some, I think, that come to be teachers. And I think Mike was a teacher for our family. And if we all didn't learn something from Mike, then we should have.
Scott.
Scotty boy.
Scotty body Scotty. Squatty body Scotty.
Very sports-minded, wanted to play sports and throw balls, and very active.
He is a big personality, which is saying a lot in a family that is full of big personalities.
Scott kind of has just a smile on his face, you might say a grin, and so it's just a natural grin. But he was a teller at Bank of America, and people would come and be angry about something or want a problem solved. And, you know, sometimes one of the guys said once, "Stop laughing. This is not funny." And Scott's going,
he actually threatened him. He was going to wait outside for him.
Yeah.
Scott's role in the family, the stereotypical smart aleck of the family, I think that he easily irritated people. And I think it amused him. So I think that was just kind of his role, was just to kind of ruffle everybody's feathers, and he thought it was hilarious.
I wouldn't say that I was the smart aleck. I was smart, but not the smart aleck. You know what I mean? I don't remember being mouthy, unless it was just in good fun.
And Scott, you know, he was kind of a smart aleck. As
well,
he grew
for example,
up.
Would be trying to help Mike read. Scott would sneak around and come up and kind of put his head over the back of the couch. So if we were reading like this, he'd be right here and start reading to us. He was a very smart kid.
I was just trying to keep my head down and stay out of trouble for the most part.
Stephen was a great baby. I mean, Stephen was really easygoing.
Steve, definitely, his personality was a lot more calm and soft and a little more sweet.
Stephen and Kayleen were a pair. Kayleen would wake up in the morning and put on Stephen's clothes. When she was little, she wanted to wear his clothes.
Stephen's one of the best people I know, to be quite honest with you. He's one of the best people I know. If he cares about you, he will give you the shirt off his back. Like the rest of the people in my family, I think he has an incredible capacity to care about people.
Football was always a big deal for Scott and Steve, and I remember that playing a big role in our family and in their lives during that time when they were going through high school with that. I still remember waking up in the mornings and having mom go outside to do her Westwood cheer for both Scott and Steve on their game days. And I was always so proud of them.
So then there's three boys right in a row, Mike, Scott, and Steven. And it was crazy. Life was crazy.
They were hard as little brothers. They were just hard. They were fun. They always could find something to do, good and bad. They always kept themselves busy.
And I mean, even as a mother now, I'm trying to picture how chaotic that would be, because I think my life is chaotic.
Mike, Scott, and Steve, and Kayleen, poor Kayleen, she had those three big brothers in front of her.
She definitely had some of the boys' tendencies, and she was the wild child of the girls. That's definitely what I would say her role was.
Kayleen had to be a fighter. She had these three boys that were just relentless in bugging her or teasing her, whatever it is. She was like the lightning rod for these little guys.
We were definitely the older sibling picking on the younger sibling, and I just wanted to hang out with her and be friends with her friends, but I was young enough to where it was weird a little bit. I've always have just respected Kayleen's opinion of all things that I do. I think we've come a long way from the days of me yelling that I hate her for ruining my room or for picking on me at some point.
And Afton, of course, is the baby of the family.
What makes her the baby?
Because she's the youngest.
What does that look like?
I was in high school. I remember because it was in November. It was football season, and I was actually at a football game. My Uncle Rick and Aunt Denny had it announced at the football game that number 10, Willis Afton, had just arrived. And that's how I found out, was over the loudspeaker at the football game.
Afton was a unifier. Afton is a unifier. She had nine brothers and sisters that loved her.
And she had nine moms and dads,
yeah,
too.
That's true.
You know, telling her what to do.
The older half always thought that she was overly babied, had better stuff, got better things, got to do what she wanted, better experiences, because that was just where she fell. And let's face it, mom and dad were real tired by then.
Growing up, I think she got a lot of things that, I didn't necessarily do, or, you know, she traveled a lot and saw a lot of different things. And, her childhood was different, very different, and growing up and even through high school, very different from any of the other kids.
Definitely the baby of the family. She grew up in an adult world. Her friends were the siblings. Her friends were family.
I think there were a lot of luxuries Afton and myself experienced that a lot of, and I use luxuries very loosely. I think there were a lot of differences in the way that we grew up than how the older kids grew up. I think it's that way in any family.
I don't know. I feel like some people might be bothered by always being the youngest of a big family. But I've always really loved it. I've always taken such pride in all of my siblings and being a part of the Willis family. If I had to choose a spot, 1 through 10, I'm glad that I ended up at number 10.
Afton, really, it felt like it had she had finished our family in a good way.
My favorite thing about mom is that mom knows how to get stuff done. I know that if I call her with an issue or with things I'm overwhelmed with, she will make a plan and she will do it and she will follow through on anything that we need.
She taught all of us to be strong, especially, I would say, especially the girls. I can always remember her telling myself and others other siblings in the family that you are only allowed to feel bad for yourself for 5 minutes and then you're done. I think that just translates to being happy and finding joy and accepting your lot in life and moving on.
Saying the things that need to be said, really. And, you know, some people may not like that, but it's one of my favorite things about my mom. She deals with things head on. And, you know, sometimes that's the best way to handle it.
I've always thought my mom was really good at doing hard things. Just in general, whatever it was, whether she had a difficult calling, raising 10 kids.
She can do anything. All she has to do is decide I'm going to do it, and she can do it. And she takes care of people and the world around her. Always. She's just going to, she, in my eyes, makes the world turn.
Margie is unbelievable. To have 10 children, maybe if you had 2 or 3 assistants, you could do it, but most people can't do it. She's just been a wonderful wife. I don't know who else I would have chosen instead of her. But you don't know that when you first get into a relationship. You have to say, I'm sticking with it no matter what. She loves me back, so. I guess that's as much as I've learned. And I mean that positively.
What?
Edit that to make it sound better, would you?
Something that I love about my dad is that he loves people and that people love him. I remember riding in the car with him when I was quite young, but riding down Orange Street and somebody had waved to him and he waved back. And I said, who was that? And he said, I don't know. I wouldn't ever want somebody to feel like I was unfriendly. And that's how he lived his life. He wanted people to know that he was interested in them and he is just good at talking to people.
Favorite thing now is that he loves our kids' ball games. You know, even some of the games that we don't want to go to, he loves to go to and just to be there and support them. And they see my mom and dad there and, you know, it says that this is, hey, you know, this is important.
He loves watching the kids do their thing and loves watching them in their element. And whether it's sports or they're performing, he's very, very proud of the grandkids, and you can tell by the way he interacts with them.
Well, Dad was Bishop at 54th Ward. All of my friends used to tell me, your dad is really scary. He probably hates me. I know he's pissed at me. He sits up on the stand and just stares at me. And honestly, I would have to tell them, my dad probably doesn't even know who you are. Because that's just what he looks like. But once they would get to know him and he would tell a great story and interact with them, that was always my favorite. And having people get to know his real personality, because never in my life have I thought my dad was scary. That was not any way part of his personality growing up. If anything, my mom was probably the scary one if you made her mad. So I always loved that about my dad.
I think my favorite thing about my dad is the way people love him. It takes a certain personality to be able to get along with people so easily and so well. He is easy to love, and he loves others easily.
I think I would never want to do something that would disappoint my parents. And so I think it pushes me to a different level of being able to do hard things and to push through, whether it's school or whether it's a job that's difficult or having children, raising kids.
They're not looking to get patted on the back for the good things they do. And, you know, they probably aren't going to tell you about them. I think there's probably a million things that they've both done that we have no idea that have been helpful to us, each other, or just the people around us, especially our neighborhood and our ward.
You can be a parent, but to be committed to being a parent, and that I'm going to be the best parent I can be. They weren't perfect, but you can't, I mean, you'd be hard to come by two better people to be parents. And they did a really great job.
What are some of your favorite things about Lance?
You know, there's a lot of favorite things I have about Lance. From the very beginning, when we were first married, you know, he always said, we need to find something to laugh about. Find humor in all the chaos and all the hard times. He was a husband that dug right in and helped with the kids. He rocked Afton until she was probably 10 years old, rocked her to sleep. He made me want to do the right thing. I didn't grow up in a house where scriptures were read and family prayer and all of those things. And I saw that in him, and I wanted that for our family. And besides that, he was really good at rubbing my back too, you know.
Loved being the oldest of the kids, loved being the oldest of 10 children, and each time another child joined our family, more personality, more learning how to get along with a new person in the family.
Being a mom is actually the hardest thing I had ever done. I had 9 babies in 12 years and 10 babies in 15 years, and all the way in between there was chaos and confusion.
I think a large family is hard for a lot of reasons. There's a lot of fun that comes with it, and I'm forever grateful that I grew up in a large family.
Childhood was enjoyable for the most part. I remember some of the bad stuff, but for the most part, in general, childhood was enjoyable, and I wouldn't change a thing.
Trying to do all the family home evenings and read the scriptures and have family prayer. I remember at one point during our family home evenings, I had a little yellow plastic bat, the little wiffle ball bats, and I would put it kind of right here. And I'm sure the boys will remember that. And I would just put it right there and just, you know, if you make a peep, boom. You know?
Life is crazy, life is chaotic, but at the same time, as a child, I remember good feelings of being at home and feeling pride in my siblings that we were a family.
You're always part of something. You appreciate that more as you get older, you know, because it's a good little security blanket around you.
I don't think I ever fully appreciated it until I had my own children. You can't. And then you suddenly realize, I can't believe Mom and Dad were able to do what they did.
When you have 10 children, there's always somebody that's unhappy. I think we've done a pretty good job of keeping most of them happy. We tried to support them in every activity that they did. I didn't care if it was a singing group, we would try to go.
I took it a day at a time and tried to learn from my mistakes. When those kids came to us, I swore I was going to be a good mom. And so whether they think I was or not, I did the best I knew how to do, because they were our children. They were on loan to us from Heavenly Father, and I was trying to give them every opportunity that I could to have them reach their potential. And you know what? I think they have. I think they've done a really good job.
Who is your parents' favorite child?
Who is my parents' favorite child? Favorite child might just be timing. based on who's doing what at the time.
But that's a little bit of a cop-out. I want to know who's your parents' favorite child.
Who's my parents' favorite child? Well, it's not me. I don't feel like it's me.
Who do you think is your parents' favorite child?
Not me in either case.
Who is your parents' favorite child?
Me.
No hesitation.
No, me. My parents' favorite child, I'm going to be honest, I really do think it's me.
I really do! Mom and Dad will never say out loud that they have a favorite child. But Mom did clearly say to me once, I love all my children the same, but some of them are just easier to love. And I definitely count myself as one of the easiest to love.
If you asked me this, maybe even like 3 or 5 years ago, I would have instantly said me. For sure I am the favorite child. And then maybe the past few years, I started realizing they really like Amy too. She does a lot for them. Mom really, really respects Amy's opinion.
I feel like maybe Dad's favorite child would probably be one of the boys, especially if they played football.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe Afton. Maybe Afton is the favorite child.
If I had to say him in, I'd probably say, well, Dave, their oldest son, was, you know, Dad's favorite. And, you know, he probably, you know, growing up, I saw mm-hmm. that. I looked up to Dave and wanted to be like him, yeah.
I think my mom's favorite is probably Afton. And I think my dad's favorite is David. But if you had to add, like, if they had to come together, if my parents had to come together and it's like, we have to agree on a favorite, I think it would be me.
It wouldn't be either of their favorites. They would just give it to somebody else.
No, because I think they would just, I just think together they kind of are like, and maybe it's this, maybe it's like, I think my parents kind of know that I need that.
Lance, who's your favorite child?
I cannot put a value to one of my children over another.
I'll tell you, my favorite person named Jessica is Jessica. My favorite person named Amy is Amy. My favorite person named David is David. My favorite twins are Melanie and Melissa. My favorite...
So you don't have a favorite?
Michael is Michael. And you know what? They are all favorites at different times of their life.
Well, it's not the answer I was looking for, but it was a good one still.
We bought this lot. We'd gone in with Ted Williams to buy a big lot, and we divided it in half.
We were the first house to be built down there at the end.
Orange Street was a great place to raise kids. There was probably 100 kids between Layton's to Montague's.
Growing up on Orange Street, there was a lot of pride. A lot of pride. Not just our own family being proud of living on Orange Street, but all the families that lived on Orange Street.
It was a special place. And I remember growing up, and I mean, I didn't even know like a Scottsdale World or an Aituke or a nicer place existed. I thought this is as good as it gets.
It was just it was a great place to live. The kids could go outside, they could run and play, they could ride their bikes, you know, without having to get hit by a car and those sort of things.
I lived in a 2-mile radius, and my whole entire world was in that 2 miles. Church, store, school, friends, family, everyone was right there.
I mean, that is like, that's all I knew. I didn't venture all the way to Hossack where I'm at now. Like that, please, that was way too far.
We felt like there was a camaraderie, there was a family feel on the street. We knew everybody on the street, and every single house, there was somebody that was your age that somebody could play with.
Good neighbors and people who put up with our shortcomings and our struggles, and they were okay with us, and we did the same for them.
It was nice to feel like you had family and friends around, and there were a lot of people around that supported us and, you know, supported our family and loved our family, mainly because of our parents and, you know, what they did and, you know, all the service that they've done over the years. So it was nice to be part of that and feel part of that. I think that's why a lot of us still live here.
But Orange Street is home. That's why when we came home from Argentina, while we were there, I just said, we need to find a house on Orange Street. That's where we need to live. So we had, our kids had good friends. You know, we had good neighbors. What more could you want?
Traditions for the Willis family are very slim pickings.
Of course, every Christmas Eve, we were always filmed saying Merry Christmas 1979, 1980, 1981.
Merry Christmas 1988!
Part of Christmas also, I always remember my dad being sick around Christmas. I don't know if it was an allergy thing, like that time of year, or if it was all the money that he was bleeding out at Christmas time. But I do remember my dad being sick almost every Christmas.
I remember several years on Christmas Eve, Mom would take the video camera down Orange Street and ask everyone and film everyone, you know, what are you doing on Christmas Eve? It went from a few words or sentences to the Larry John family, you know, singing an entire song. Something I always have loved about my mom is the paper Christmas tree. When my mom was growing up, Christmas was a really big deal. It wasn't a hodgepodge. It was fancy, and I remember going with Mom a few times to get the fancy flocked Christmas tree, and how it was, you know, it was a really big deal, and it was important to her to try to keep up that tradition, that she wanted a nice Christmas tree. And I remember one year we had the three little boys who were the wild ones, and I remember that tree getting pulled down not once, but about three or four times, a live tree. And I remember by the last time it got pulled over and needles are on the floor and it's hardly even looking like a tree anymore, she just said, that's it, we're done. And she chucked the Christmas tree, she got some green butcher paper, and she cut out a paper Christmas tree and stuck it on the wall. And then she put one of our little apple ornaments that had our names on each one on the five limbs on each side that she had drawn. And that was our Christmas tree. It probably was a good 2 weeks before Christmas, and maybe even 3 weeks. And that was the tree that year, and that's what the presents went around, and she rolled with it. She made it amazing.
And we will still always gather for family dinners, either for Thanksgiving and holidays, or just our fast Sunday dinners. We have good food traditions, I guess, which we like eating, which it says a lot.
And we always had prayer, and we always had devotional, usually on Sunday, which usually ended in someone crying, often Mom.
One of my memories that I have is every year before school started, my dad giving us father's blessing. What a neat thing for our father to be able to give us a blessing to be able to start the school year out.
I love that tradition. Love that tradition. I thought it was great. I think what I valued the most from that is I was in a room by myself with my parents. I was in a room by myself with my parents, and all of their attention was just on me.
For me, it was valuable time just to, you know, it was quiet moment with Mom and Dad that really you didn't have much of when I was growing up.
Dad's role as a priesthood leader has always been a big part of my view of him. I remember when Dad got called as bishop, in the 8th ward and being so proud that that was my dad. And I think, I believe I was fairly young at that point, because I remember him always just being up in the stand, sitting there for his church callings.
He always was a worthy priesthood holder, and I probably took that for granted. We always grew up with it. It was always there. When Kyle moved to Mesa in, I believe it was the middle of 8th grade, and so he immediately was in the young men's program, and my dad was there. And Kyle always talks about what an amazing influence he was. And Kyle's mom said to me the other day, "I need to tell your dad, I've always wanted to tell him how much I appreciated him being a father figure for Kyle."
I spent a couple years before my mission home teaching with Dad, and we had a particular family in the ward. Every single month we went to visit them, she would ask for a priesthood blessing, and she was sick. And I remember watching my dad every month, with this brother, her husband, blessing his wife with my dad, and my dad assisting him in administering blessings of the priesthood. And that was valuable for me as a late teenager and pre-missionary. Yeah.
He was a great young men's president, and he was a great bishop, and very, very likable. It's really saying a lot to have young men and young women enjoy your parents.
We had a call from Wilfred Anderson, who had talked to me and said, they've asked about your availability. And I said, well, what's it about? And he said, probably to be a mission president. He didn't confirm it. I hadn't heard from anybody. And somebody called and left a note that, please be at the Stake Center in Chandler on this date at this time.
And so we just kind of, went to a church and met with Elder Robert D. Hales. He just kind of, he met us, and I was a little nervous, but I was fine. And he walks in, and Elder Hales, shook our hand, and he says, "Well, do you know why you're here?" And Lance makes the comment to him.
I said, "Well, I understand Lavelle Edwards resigned as coach of BYU's football team." See, I've always been kind of a smart aleck.
And, my mouth wanted to drop open. And I just was,
And he doesn't say a word. He's on oxygen. I mean, the poor guy can barely travel. And he doesn't need some smart aleck to tell him jokes. He kind of thumbs through it and pulls out a paper, and he said, "Doesn't look like you're in that business." I said, "I apologize. I don't know how that came out. I'm sorry."
And so then he set us down, and then he actually, talked to us, asked us about our family and about our parents, if our parents were healthy, and about our finances and business and that sort of thing. All of a sudden, the spirit in the room kind of changed. And he paused for a minute, and he just looked at us, and Elder Hale said, "I want you to go home and gather your children around you and tell them you're leaving to go on a mission."
He said, "In November, you'll get a call from the First Presidency. And when they call, pay attention." Just like that. I said, "Yes, sir." Now, we knew it was going to be Spanish speaking. That's the only thing we knew. So we got all the church newses that we could online. And we looked to see which ones are being replaced, because all mission presidents are 3 years.
So we put all of the countries in the order of, we hope we go here, we hope we go there, we go. Well, Lance's mom and dad had served in Ecuador as regional representatives, and his mom had told us, Guayaquil, Ecuador is the nastiest, dirtiest place in the world. I hope you don't ever have to go there.
We made Ecuador south our worst one that we did not want to see. And my mother agreed, said that is the smelliest place I've ever been.
Well, the first memory I have is that Dave had held the, mom and dad's favorite kid, had held the call up to the light and somehow figured out where they were going before they knew.
So we opened it and started going down the wording just like the young missionaries do. And I said, Ecuador, Guayaquil South. And my mother and Afton just burst into sobs.
Afton just broke out sobbing because she knew she was going with us. And all of us, we were all just in shock that it was our last choice is where we were going.
It didn't matter. It didn't matter where they went. They did an amazing job, and it was where they were supposed to be.
I did feel bad for Afton, but also excited because I knew that she was going to experience something none of the rest of us got to experience.
And everybody just kept saying, oh, Afton, this will be the greatest experience, of your life. And I just remember Afton saying, well, then why don't you go and I'll stay home? So it was tough on her for a long time.
We were to go to Salt Lake, or actually to Provo, to the Mission President Seminar. And then Elder Scott came and personally set us apart.
And I just remember him expressing the love that he had for Dad. And you could just tell that he thought really highly of Dad and of Mom for taking this call, and that he had a special place in his heart for Dad, and that he really loved it.
I loved Ecuador for a number of things. I really learned to love the people, especially these ones up in the mountains. That was the first time that I had a major call. I'd never been in a state presidency. But that, I was amazed that I was ever called. Maybe that's the kind they want, somebody that's amazed at being called.
Overall, it really ended up being one of the greatest experiences I've ever had. It definitely shaped me in a way to show me there is more than just the 2 mile radius of Orange Street in Mesa, Arizona. And I think I really clung to those experiences I received. I always took a lot of pride in the fact that he was my dad and that he was able to carry these responsibilities and take on these callings. And everywhere we went, everyone would call him, oh, Presidente, Presidente, and treat him like royalty. And it always would just fill me with pride to see him like that and doing those callings and knowing that he was so humble and so loving to these missionaries, and to know that that was such a big part of his life. Church is everything to him.
That mission turned out to be the perfect spot for us. We needed to go to a place where there were poor people, humble people. We had 500 of the greatest missionaries come through there, in 3 years, and we just learned to love them. It was our perfect place for us. I think we fit right in Guayaquil.
What are some things that you hope people will remember you for?
I want them to remember that I was always active. I always had an assignment in the church. I want them to know that.
Why is that important?
Because that's something that I have done that I believe will make a difference in their lives as well.
I am most proud of the fact that I have learned a lot from life, that I didn't let the hard times of life get the best of me, they might have got me down sometimes, but they didn't get the best of me. You need to have a lot of hope and faith and endure to the end. I understand that concept now, so I'm proud that I let myself do that.
When I think about Mom and Dad, I think about what a big impact they are on my life and my siblings' life, and even just for everyone who knows them. But I know when Mom and Dad think of themselves, they just think of themselves as these two people who have struggled through life and have tried to do the best that they could. They don't realize what a great legacy that they have built. I will always be grateful for their humility and for their examples and the hard work that they have put in loving us, even though we might not be very special or very much to other people. This family of ours has created a legacy, and I hope Mom and Dad will always see that and know how important they are to this.
Thank you, Lance. That'll do it.
Are we done?
We're done.
All right. Make me look as good as possible.
My favorite story of my mom, and I don't know how old I was. I think I was in 9th grade, though. So my mom coming out of the laundry room with an empty laundry hamper, just one of those round laundry hampers, over the top of her head. I'm sure just like still in pajamas or whatever, it's morning time, I'm not sure what she was wearing, but my dad was making us breakfast and my mom comes out of the laundry room with the laundry hamper over the top of her head like an insane woman, dancing and singing across the kitchen. And what made it so great is how mortified my dad was, and my mom didn't care. And that is one of my favorite memories of my mom. I loved it so much.
I'm not gonna stay.
I was very proud that my dad made breakfast almost every single morning. He helped wake us up in the morning. I remember him coming into our bedrooms and pulling up the blinds and singing the BYU Cougar fight song. That's how we woke up in the mornings, is dad getting us up and going. And then he made the best eggs, just like Grandpa Willis did. Dad made the best eggs.
When I wrap my arms around you, every mistake we
made. We would be going grocery shopping and Mom would start pushing the cart and dancing. And she would push it really far out and then do a little dance and start tapping, and we would just have to walk away really fast. And Dad, bless his heart, has done well letting Mom embarrass him, because I know it just kills him inside. So many times he's just not that way.
Baby, be prepared to be surprised. It's all.
I can remember him sitting at the head of the table and just getting his wallet out and pulling out just wads of cash, and he would lay it out. I'm not sure if he went from highest to lowest or from lowest to highest, but it was all in order of bill from biggest to lowest or lowest to biggest, whatever. And he would make sure that all the bills, the face of the president was facing up and everything was upright, and all the corners, if a corner of the bill was creased, all the corners were completely flat. So it was just this perfect style stack of cash. Then he put it back in his wallet.
When I wrap my arms around you.
There was a story of, back when we had the white Suburban, of me and my friends stole a plastic snowman. This was around the holidays. We drove around down Brown Road and over to University and back down Date Street with this snowman dragging out the back of the Suburban. And apparently someone had called the cops saying someone is being dragged behind a Suburban. So we were pulled over at gunpoint. I was driving, so they brought us here with all of my friends, and the cop brought, there was probably four or five of us, to the front porch, knocked on the door, and Dad came to the door in his shorts and garment top, to, oh, what's going on? And it's a police officer with his boys, and it seemed, I remember thinking, he wasn't shocked, didn't really say anything about it. Most people would say, oh no, what happened? Or be really mad. And he was just kind of, you know, the cop explained what happened, and you know, I'm escorting these guys home for the night, here you go. And we all shuffled in with our heads down. Dad said, Scotty, I'm getting too old for this. And he just walked back down the hall to bed. And you know, all my buddies who came out to the TV room were laughing like, oh yeah. Saying
everyone will be all right. Okay, my favorite memory of Grandma Ashton, and my mom is probably gonna kill me.
Okay.
But her saying, Lordy, Lordy, Lordy. And whether or not that's true, still to this day, I have memories and memories of Grandma Ashton just going, Lordy, Lordy, Lordy. And I can remember laughing and thinking that was so great, and I love that about her. And my mom just saying, no, we don't do that. No, we don't say that.